I'd like to welcome you to the University of Scranton on this historic day in the life of the university. I would like to offer a special thank you to Father Rodolfo Cardinale, my brother Jesuit, who is with us today from his home in Nicaragua. Father Cardinale arrived in Scranton on Monday evening, and from here he will go on to speak at St. Joseph's University in Philadelphia and then on to Boston College. We are honored that he agreed to make the University of Scranton his first stop on this trip to the United States. In 1980, El Salvador, a small country in Central America, essentially the size of Massachusetts, witnessed the assassination of their beloved Archbishop, Oscar Romero, by a government death squad. A long, threatening civil war broke out shortly after the martyrdom of the Archbishop, and during the next 12 years, more than 77,000 people were murdered. The young Jesuit University in El Salvador, the University of Central America, more commonly known as the UCA, just 15 years old, found itself at the center of this catastrophe. Speaking out for justice during this time was tantamount to accepting a death sentence. On November 16, 1989, six Jesuits, their housekeeper, and her 15-year-old daughter were gunned down in their sleep by government militants. The martyrs never wavered in speaking the truth, exposing atrocities, and proposing solutions. And they did this as a university, as a Catholic and Jesuit university, just like our Catholic and Jesuit university. As I mentioned at Convocation and at the Mass of the Holy Spirit, we at Scranton are marking the 20th anniversary of their deaths and continue our commitment to the call of solidarity with those in the world where justice is so desperately needed still today. We continue to be inspired by those who promote the rights of others, for the poor, and for those who cannot speak for themselves. Archbishop Romero called all of us to be the voice of the voiceless. That is exactly what our Jesuit brothers and their co-workers were in 1989 and continue to do today at the UCA, inspiring us to do the same at the University of Scranton. St. Ignatius taught us to give and not to count the cost, to fight and not to heed the wounds, to toil and not to seek for rest, to labor and not to ask for reward, except that of knowing that we do God's will. It was this lesson which led to the ultimate sacrifice of these women and men who lived their lives in service to others and in search of justice for the oppressed. November 16, 1989 is a day that will be forever remembered at Jesuit universities and schools around the world, including the University of Scranton. Here at Scranton, we are reflecting on the lives of those lost that day. We are remembering their sacrifice today at this lecture, and also at a special Mass on Sunday, November 15th, and at a coffee and conversation opportunity with students, faculty, staff, and Jesuits on the actual anniversary, Monday evening, the 16th of November, in the DeNaples Center. We are also thrilled that Professor Marie Caron will represent us at the UCA on the 16th of November as part of a delegation sponsored by the United States Congress and the Association of Jesuit Colleges and Universities. In January, the senior leadership of the university and I will spend a week at the UCA, learning from our friends how we can more deeply and profoundly engage in our Catholic and Jesuit mission. Father Rodolfo Cardinale joins us today to speak to us on the legacy of the martyrs, how their mission shaped El Salvador then and still today. Father Rodolfo is the former vice rector of the UCA and lived at the UCA during much of their civil war and at the time of the murders 20 years ago. As vice rector, he was the equivalent to what we would know in the United States as the provost and vice president for academic affairs. Through his work, the UCA currently participates in debates on public issues and provides constructive criticism to aid the poor in El Salvador, which accounts for the vast majority of that country's population. The work of the UCA provides an opportunity for those involved to critique problems and to propose solutions, supported by their scholarship and their Catholic and Jesuit ideals. We thank Father Cardinal for inspiring the students at the UCA and for being with us today. Please join me in welcoming Rodolfo Cardinal of the Society of Jesus to the University of Scranton.
Thank you very much. The UCA Martyrs are part of the tradition of the Salvadoran Church. In El Salvador, the word martyrs is used to name a multitude of witnesses. The 6 Jesuits of the UCA and their 2 collaborators are among them. We are gathered here today to pay respect to their memory and be thankful for their life and death. We are not only commemorating another year of their martyrdom, but also this anniversary introduces us to an intense time of commemoration, a time to remember and to be thankful. Now, we are celebrating the 20th anniversary of the martyrdom of the Jesuit of the UCA and their assistants. Next March, we will commemorate the 30th anniversary of Monsignor Romero's martyrdom. In May, we will remember the massacre of the Sumpul River. Also, in December, we will commemorate the 30th anniversary of the martyrdom of the 4 religious American women who were sexually assaulted and brutally murdered. These martyrs call out to us in a powerful way. At every anniversary, they call out to innumerable communities in El Salvador and throughout the world that unite to venerate them and give thanks for their testimony. Nevertheless, the memory of these martyrs for justice is enigmatic. On one hand, their memory fascinates and attracts many. On the other hand, it never ceases to evoke fear because it always makes us wonder. It forces us to ask ourselves why their lives were taken away, what causes they defended, and who is responsible for their murder. Once these questions are answered, a more disturbing one emerges. Because of what it implies, and because it becomes a personal question, the martyrs for justice are also asking us how we are going to give continuity to their cause. Therefore, many ignore them, even though there has been much cruelty and generosity. Others remain quiet or hide the reason of their martyrdom to deny their relevance. But many others, without fear and with joy, place these martyrs at the center of their faith because their passion is the most real actualization of Jesus' passion and resurrection. They believe that the martyrs resemble Jesus in life and death. They consider them his disciples in terms of compassion towards human suffering, in the prophetic denunciation of injustice, and in the strength in the face of adversity and persecution. They think that their death is like that of Jesus, a consequence of his life, a life given unto death. That is the life that God resurrects. Monsignor Romero is the best example of these three attitudes. Some accuse him of political extremism. Others recognize his sacrifice, but they portray him as a good and holy priest. For the majority of the Salvadoran people, and for many others, he is the prophet who denounced injustice and sin, the bishop who defended the poor and the victims. That is why, even today, he is seen as their shepherd. In him, their faith is confirmed, and their hope is strengthened. In truth, to give recognition to these martyrs is not an easy task, because one must also accept the mystery of giving one's life for the poor and the victims. Martyrs such as Monsignor Romero, the Jesuits of the UCA, and the American religious women exist because they defended victims from their executioner, and because the cruelty from which they had to be liberated was unbearable for human reason and Christian faith. They were touched by the suffering of the victims in a way that moved them to devote their lives to alleviating it. They never rationalized. They never compromised with it. The victims' suffering became for them an absolute, because in these victims they found God. The martyrs devoted their lives to free and save others from injustice and oppression. From a theological perspective, they fought to free the world from sin. Therefore, their dedication is love and compassion, with the particularity of also being defender of the lives of the oppressed. In them, the mercy became a passion for justice and a radical option for the poor and the victims. Hence, they were persecuted and murdered. When we place them at the side of the victims, the martyrs become eloquent. They reveal to us the mystery of the evil that took their lives from them, and the mystery of God that seduced them. The victims point to the absolute, to that which we cannot manipulate, to the hungry and the poor, and to God, who is found at their side. Therefore, the martyrs cannot be remembered without remembering the victims that moved them to give up their lives. One would almost have to name each of them without forgetting anyone. Thus, we would remedy the barbarity and return to them their dignity. And we would also understand why the martyrs exist. The life and death of the martyrs of the UCA shows us the path to come nearer to the mystery of God and encourage us to respond as they did to the question directed towards humanity since the beginning of history. What have you done for your brother and for your sister? They told the truth about the reality of the world and El Salvador. They gave reasons for hope, and they gave concrete signs of the active presence of the kindness of God. In this way, they served the society of Jesus and the church. But in the final instance, they served the poor and God. Finally, the martyrs and victims refer us to the mystery of God. What we are going to do to give continuity to their cause, the cause of the poor and of God, is an open question. The global crisis raises the question of the fate of our brothers and sisters. The fall of the Colossus of Wall Street not only has put in grave danger global financial stability, but also created more unemployment, more poverty, and more hunger in the world. As a result, in the next few years, more children and adults will die. It is possible that the billions of dollars that governments injected into their financial systems is making the most powerful economies able to grow again. Nevertheless, we cannot forget that the human drama has not disappeared, nor has it received the same attention from these governments. The satisfaction of the basic needs is considered a second-class social issue. The lives of millions of people around the world are worth so little that they do not figure on the list of priorities of political agendas. Today, so much is said about controlling the financial system, of cutting the scandalous earnings of its directors, and of requiring larger monetary reserves of the banks. Would they keep silent about the fate of the unemployed, the hungry, and the poor? The criterion for declaring an end to the crisis should not be economic growth, but the disappearance of hunger, the drastic reduction in poverty, and universal employment. The consequences of this human failure are found everywhere. You do not need to go far to see them. If we look around us, a little beyond ourselves, we will come across this world of poor and excluded. Immigrants who flee from poverty and death have brought it with them to the United States. Their presence is an invitation to allow yourself to be moved by this human exodus, to ask about its causes, and to seek effective solutions. That is precisely what the martyrs of the UCA did when they asked themselves what to do as a university. They put themselves in the place of the poor and the victims. When they asked themselves how to do it, the knowledge and wisdom of the university helped them to discover the truth of injustice and oppression. When they asked themselves what path to take, a utopia showed them on the horizon a more human, brotherly, and united world. These questions are asked from two basic presuppositions. The first is that the martyrs of the UCA had the audacity and courage to see beyond the campus of their university. Around them, they found the world of the poor and victims, and they allowed themselves to be moved by their suffering without reserve and without keeping anything for themselves. The second presupposition is that the university, by its nature, united in its breast a multiplicity of knowledge and information needed to contribute to overcoming the problem of humanity without diminishing its academic excellence. The secret consists in putting this knowledge and wisdom at the service of the poor and the excluded. When the university's contribution is considered from the Christian perspective, it is no longer optional and becomes an ethical issue. A university that declares itself Christian cannot tolerate the positive irrationality that shapes the world today. The Christian is obligated to free the world from sin, and injustice and oppression are sins. The university that puts itself at the service of the cause of the poor and the victims has resolved the question of its Jesuit and Christian identity, because they seal that identity with their suffering and their longing for justice and freedom. The martyr of the UCA always looked for the greatest glory of God. A fundamental principle of the spirituality of St. Ignatius. In their search, they found, like Monsignor Romero and many others, that the greatest glory of God was that the poor should live. For this reason, instead of being satisfied with the achievement and success of the UCA, they listened to the clamor of the Salvadoran people and placed themselves in the service of their liberation. Moses believes he hears the frightening voice that called him to listen to the clamor of an oppressed people that reaches unto God. That voice does not call him to admire the greatness and beauty of the immense granite structure that astonish us today. In them, no voice is heard, neither that of the oppressed nor that of God. Faithful to the call of a God that desires to free from injustice and oppression, the martyrs placed themselves in the center of the Salvadoran conflict. They did not involve themselves in the conflict motivated by hate, but because they took pity on the Salvadoran people. They understood that it was a call to collaborate with their liberation. This explained the high price they paid for their boldness. They were killed for crossing the line of what was permitted by the unjust power. Monsignor Romero said that entering the pit of iniquity was like touching a high voltage cable without any protection. Martyrdom does not occur them by doing good, but rather by placing yourself at the center of the historical conflict. There is where the life and death of humanity is decided. Father Ellacuría said provocatively that it was necessary to subvert history in order to transform the predominant common evil at present into a common good. The martyrs of the UCA were convinced of the possibility of subverting history so that the goods that were common could be shared by all humanity. They believed that the liberating promise of God could be realized in history, because it is already found in history since the death and resurrection of Jesus. Inspired by his spirit, they worked to construct a new brotherly united humanity. Therefore, utopia is not what has no place, because something of utopia is realized in history. despite the existence of powerful forces that insist of impeding it. The martyrs were utopians, but not dreamers, nor naive. Utopia showed them where they should direct their steps. They did not hesitate in proceeding in that direction. But they were supported by prophecy, which told them where they should not go. Utopia pushed them forward. But where utopia assented to an advance, prophecy denied it. And where prophecy denied, utopia affirmed the news of the reign of God. In this way, their lives were a prophetic path driven by utopia. For that reason, they were never satisfied with their accomplishment. They never were discouraged by failure and never gave up. They always looked forward towards the utopia of a new creation, a new humanity that they had envisioned from the darkness and the abandonment of the poor and the victims. They resisted because they were men of deep faith and because they kept hope even against all hope. Without hope, it is impossible to enter the world of the poor and victims. Those who hope believe that God is faithful to his promise, that death will not triumph over life. Those who hope believe that the last word of history belongs to God, even if he is silent or seems powerless. However, this does not mean passivity or expectation. Instead, the hope is lucid action oriented toward the future. But it is a date against hope, because it takes over the world of the poor and the victims, because it passes through the momentary triumph of the executioner over the victim, because it asks about the final fate of the victims and the incomprehensible silence of God, and because it raises suspicion, adversities, and possible persecution. Let us not forget that hope is born from injustice and oppression to free the victims. Hope has never been easy, but it is real. Only hoping against hope keeps the utopian sense of a selfless life giving with love. Because of this, the slogan chosen to commemorate the 20th anniversary of the UCA martyrs proclaims that no historical boundary closes the hopeful future of a follower of Jesus. This was his hope, the hope that gave them the willingness to give their lives. The martyrs for justice present us with the mystery of a boundless love which delivers life freely in a generous and complete way. In the case of the martyrdom, we can find some rationality. But the very fact of giving away one's life does not have a satisfactory explanation. Giving away one's life is a mystery before which, as with any mystery, we must remain silent. However, it is very difficult to accept that there are people willing to give their lives and to accept that this mystery takes place among us. Life given freely for love is incomprehensible to a society where nothing is free and there are always selfish interests at stake. Sometimes we create arguments for it, but it is useless. Selfishness, arrogance, and frivolity prevent us from recognizing the free surrender to others. Therefore, the matters and the greatness of their generosity and their love are a prophetic sign that only the pure in heart are able to see. Although it is difficult to accept the mystery of the surrendering life for love, martyrs are models that we really need. They are good people who offer up to us their faith, their hopes, and boundless generosity and love. We find in them the fundamental values that can turn us to solidarity, compassion, and passion for justice. We find in them a real chance to be more human. But this possibility is only real if we turn to them, if we let ourselves be enlightened by them, and if we accept their challenge. Just as the messenger of the first day of Easter told the woman to return to Galilee to follow the path of Jesus, they also invite us today to go down this same path. It is certainly difficult to walk like them, but with them, walking towards God alongside the poor and the victims becomes easier. Today we remember those martyrs who, from the powerlessness of their sacrifice, from the humiliation of their murder, and from the wickedness of the cover-up of their assassinations, highlight the unfair powers that killed them and still kill millions of people through hunger and violence. In this sense, the memory of the martyrs is protest and resistance. In the martyrs, the presence of God is manifested with strength and clarity. The first to see it had been the poor. They have a very developed sense of faith and understand those who speak to them of the mystery of God. Likewise, they have a very developed sense of love and understand those who speak to them of the love of God. They had been the one who, with greater clarity, more quickly have understood that the martyrs resemble Jesus. In them, they see compassion toward the weak, prophecy against oppression, and confidence in God. In fact, there are more and more testimonies of people and communities who assert that the martyrs have appeared to them and have confirmed their faith and hope. It is the luminosity of the resurrection. Those of us who are not in a situation of exclusion only have one path to participate in this passion experience: mercy, the hunger for justice, and the radical option for the victims. Along the path, the martyrs will appear to us, and with them, the goodness of God will be manifested. A goodness that invades everything and that encourages us to be good and to love. Then we also will proclaim that God has passed through El Salvador. Thank you.
Thank you, Rodolfo. for reminding us of who we are and the work that it is our sacred privilege to participate in here at this Catholic and Jesuit University. Your words were inspiring and challenging, and we're deeply grateful. Father will stay with us through lunch and would be happy to engage you in conversation. Lunch is in the atrium just behind us. Thank you all for joining us this morning.